and a suitable penalty for her being caught in the act of adultery. Then an attempt to trap him into saying something for which they could bring charges against him, they asked him, according to the law of Moses, this woman should be stoned to death. But Jesus, we want to know what you think about the situation. And first, Jesus didn't even respond to them, but he bent down and he just began to write in the sand with his finger. But they continued to press him, they continued to question him, they continued to bother him until the point where he finally stood up and he said, anyone among you that's without sin, you go to first stone. And he bent back down and began to write in the sand again with his finger. Now, the Bible doesn't say what Jesus was writing. It doesn't tell us the words. It doesn't tell us whether he was drawing pictures. It doesn't say, but if I could use my sanctified imagination for a few minutes, I believe that when Jesus bent down and began to write, he began to write the names of all her accusers. Next to their names, he began to write the sins that they had committed, who they were with the night before. The Bible says that one by one, all of her accusers left her. It's something when God puts your business in the street. So Jesus looked up and he said to the woman, where are your accusers? Where are all of those folks that wanted to condemn you for your stuff? Are they not here to accuse you? And the woman replies, no, sir. They left quickly. So Jesus says, I don't condemn you either. But as I studied this text, something struck me in what Jesus said to her. He told her not only does he not condemn her, but he sent her on her way with this warning. He said, go your way, but do not sin again. In other words, Jesus is saying, don't go back to the sin and the behavior that got you in this mess in the first place. I have exonerated you from your sin, but just because I have freed you from your sin doesn't give you reason to go back to it. Jesus gives us this second key. After our declaration of freedom, we must maintain. Somebody say maintain. Maintain our freedom. Well, preacher, how can I do that? I know Jesus has set me free, but how can I maintain my freedom once Jesus has freed me? I'm glad you asked. The answer can be found in our focus text for today. Jesus says in verse 31 that if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. The key to maintaining our liberty in Jesus Christ is the Word of God. The word for continue in the Greek is meno, and it means to stay or abide or remain or stand. Remaining in the Word of God gives us the ability to know truth. And if we are maintaining our freedom, we need the ability to discern truth in a situation from the devil's lies. Because the devil will tell you, oh, go ahead, man, I know Jesus freed you, but you know, you can take that hit one time, ain't nobody. I know you've been delivered, but you know, you can go ahead and do that. You can be around it. You don't have to give up the friends that you used to do what you do when you used to do it the way you did it and how you did it. You can still be around it and maintain your deliverance. The devil is a liar. The truth in the situation is that you may need to cut off some folks in order for you to maintain your freedom in Jesus Christ. The truth of the situation is that there are some places that you won't be able to go if you're going to maintain your freedom in Jesus Christ. The truth of the matter is that there's going to be some things that you cannot do anymore if you're going to maintain your freedom in Jesus Christ. The Word of God and the Spirit of God reveals the truth in every situation and circumstance that we face. It can reveal the truth about people.
Yes.
It can reveal the truth about systems and motives. And the Word of God will even reveal the truth about ourselves.
Amen.
In a time where lies are being passed off as truth, even among the people of faith, we need to be able to know the truth, because it is the truth that is going to make us free. It is when we know the truth and allow the truth to dictate our actions and our thoughts that we will live in the freedom that Christ provides. Now, I must warn you, my brothers and sisters, not an easy thing. This is not a light thing, but if you are going to live in liberty, it is a continual battle. It is a constant effort. It is a daily struggle. That's why we need to stay in the Word of God every single day. That's why we need to attend the church on a regular basis, where we are being taught the Word of truth, and where you have people around you that's going to encourage you to maintain your liberty and to help you be free in Jesus Christ. For the Bible says that for freedom, Christ has set us free. And so stand firm, therefore, and do not submit yourself, or do not return to the yoke of slavery that Jesus has delivered you out of. Key number one, we need to declare that we're going to be free. Tell the devil, let go of everything that concerns you, that you are busted out of this thing, because you are free in Jesus Christ. Key two, we need to maintain our freedom by remaining in the Word of God and studying in the Word of God, because the Word of God will reveal the truth of a situation and reveal the devil's lies. And the last key to our Independence Day is what's going on all around the country, and that's we need to celebrate our freedom in Jesus Christ. Celebrate your independence. Celebrate your deliverance. All over this country, there will be fireworks and parades and parties. The TV stations will be broadcasting the celebrations as they occur all around the country. But how much more should we celebrate what the Lord has done for us? I wish I had somebody to get ready to praise him with. Once a year, the whole country celebrates the independence of this nation. But I don't know about you, but I celebrate my Independence Day every day. Every day that the Lord wakes me up. A shame someone to be a homeless Christian. It's a shame for somebody to be a homeless Christian. That's a person that is saved, but don't have a church home. You need to be in a place where you're around people that can help you maintain your freedom, that will encourage you. You need to be in a place where the people of God will be able to pray with you and will be able to link up with you, to help you get stronger in Jesus Christ. And so my second appeal is, if you don't have a church home today, it's time to stop wandering. It's time for you to get rooted and grounded in a home. Don't be a homeless Christian. But we invite you to join here in your vision. I always say, if I wasn't part of the Baptist Worship Center, I probably would be here in your vision. Because this is a place where the Word of God is preached and taught with power. And it's a place where the love of God is demonstrated through the people of God. It's not a perfect church. No church is a perfect church. But this is a church that is striving to be all God called them to be. Is there one? If you want to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, or you want to join a church, just lift up your hand.
Invite them to new vision. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. thank you now the generosity of your people towards all the ministries that are in this church. We ask you to bless them as they give, bless them in their going, and bless them in their coming. Lord, we ask that you watch over them and take care of them and bring them back to us next Sunday. In Jesus' name, I pray. I'm sorry. Please don't forget our picture of the morning, Reverend Preston Thompson. There's an offering right beside Wayne on offering basket. So I believe now we begin.